Now the next topic, that is scientific techniques given by F.W. Taylor. He has given some techniques also to get the work done efficiently and effectively, and it will also beneficial for the employees and for the organization. So the first technique, that is functional foremanship. Functional foremanship. According to this technique, Taylor insists that the factory or the organization is divided into two parts. That is, one is production unit, production department, and another is planning department. This technique, it is the extension of division of work. It is the extension of principle of division of work. In this technique, Taylor insists that the organization are divided into two departments, planning department and production department. As he want that the workers, they are free from the burden of planning and they can only concentrate on the production process or producing and putting their efforts for the production of goods and services. He also suggested that these two departments are to be divided into four subdivide department each. Means in planning department it is to be divided in four subdepartment, and in production also it is also divided in four subdepartments. And in each department, experts are there, specialized are there to guide, to supervise the employees or the worker of the organization, and also to make them, by practicing these things, he wants that the worker will also improve their efficiency and they will get specialized in their work when they are doing the particular work. Next, in that he also says that in each department, in each sub department, one foreman is there for supervise or guide to their worker, to their subordinates. Because he said that one foreman, a one person, not a perfect in all aspect of in all aspects. And because of that, in each and every sub department, one foreman or appointment. So one foreman are appointed, means according to him, eight foremen are appointed, and each one of them are specialized in their own field. That is clear. So that I have told you, as he said, it is to be divided in two department, that is planning and production department. Production, and these two departments are divided into four sub department. So I'm going to tell you that which department first. The planning department, that is first one is instruction card clerk. Instruction card clerk. He is responsible to give the necessary instruction for performing the job, for carrying out the job in the organization. Next, that is route clerk. Route clerk is responsible to give the general guideline to the employees of the organization. He is there to give the general guideline to the employees of the organization, so they will perform in a well manner. Next, cost and time clock. This foreman is responsible for get the task on time, and he is also responsible to make a time sheet that how much cost is to be incurred by a particular employees and how much time they are taking to complete their task. Last, that is disciplinary. He is responsible to maintain the discipline in the organization. He is responsible for maintaining discipline in the organization. That is clear to everyone. Next department, that is production department. It is also divided in 4 department. First is gang boss. This supervisor is responsible to arrange the machine tools and equipments and raw material in the organization for carried out the production process. That is clear. And there is a big difference between gang boss and gang plan. Gang plan is for communicating if a subordinate directly communicate with the superior, then this process will be utilized and it will directly contact with that person, higher officer. And here gang boss, he is responsible for arranging the machine, tools, equipment, raw material for the production process. Next, that is speed boss. This person is responsible for get the work done on time and what time is given to them. On that time, he is responsible to carry out that work, to complete that work, to complete the task on time. He is responsible for that. Next, that is, that person is responsible repair and maintenance boss. He is responsible for checkout, for analyzing the machines are in good condition or not, and if not, he is responsible to make it repaired, so the work will be go smoothly. Last boss, that boss is responsible for what? Inspector. That supervisor is responsible to check to maintain the quality standard in the product. That is clear. So these are the people, these are the supervisor, those who are there in the firm, in the organization to guide and supervise the worker of the organization. So that is the first technique. Second technique I am going to tell you, that is standardization and simplification. Next technique, that is standardization and simplification. First, standardization. According to this technique, Taylor insists that to maintain the quality standard or to maintain the standard quality of product in the organization. He insists that in standard should be maintained right from the arrangement of raw material till finished good is delivered. If the standard is maintained from the selection of tools, equipment, machine until its use, so with the help of this, maximum output will be there by keeping in mind standard quality. Here standardization is doesn't mean only a quality standard. Here standardization it's also means standardization in size, fixed size, type, weight, quality, etc. He insists for that. So according to Taylor, standardization in the product is very necessary to maintain a quality standard as well as type, size, weight, nature, etc. That is clear to everyone. What is the objective to go with this technique and standardization technique? The objective is that first to maintain a standard quality in a given line product, to maintain a quality standard, to maintain helpful for interchangeability of man and material. That is the reason for making standardization, for using this technique. Next technique in the same topic, that is simplification. Simplification here, simplification means eliminating unnecessary diversity of product. As more varieties of product are there, more stock, more inventory, we need more number of array, more types of machines, more labor cost will be incurred by the firm. So for reducing these cost of production, Taylor suggests that the firm should go with the simplification technique also. Instead of producing more variety of products, produce less variety but produce in a well manner. For example, one company that is USA, in USA, a paper company, they were producing 200 types varieties of paper in the world. Because of that, it create more problem for them. So they reduce from 200 to 20, and now the people are success in it. They get more profit and less incurring less cost of production. That is clear to everyone. Now next technique, that is third technique, that is work study. In work study, four sub techniques are there that is come under this work study. First one is fatigue study. This technique is to be conducted to find out the number of frequency of rest interval, duration of rest interval and number of rest interval. That, as you know, when the person is working for a long time, he is bound to tired. He is bound to get tired. Obviously, when a person is performing his task or doing his job for a long period of time, a time will come when he is going to be get tired and he is not putting his efforts in a best way. So according to Taylor, he insists that there should be means the job carried out by the employees and that this time period and rest interval, it is not decided by the manager wish, his will, his intuition, on the basis of his past performance. It is to be based on scientific inquiry, that is to be conducted by fatigue study. For conducting fatigue study, he suggests that observe average workers in the organization when they are performing the task and note down at after how much time period they are going, means their energy is going to be decreased and they are getting tired. And after how much time the same person will come with the same fresh energy and he get fresh and he will put his efforts in a best manner. So by noting down, he will decide. For example, in the organization, three shifts are there. Suppose after one shift, one person is going to be get tired, and by giving a gap of second shift, he will come with the same energy that he has come at the initial stage. So they will decide, what they will decide, to give the one person, to call that person in two shift, first shift and third shift, and in second shift he will get rest in that period. And even when the first and third shift is going, a small pause of rest interval should also be given to make them fresh to put their best efforts. That is clear to everyone. Next study, that is your method study. The objective of method study, to conduct method study, is that to find the best method, the best way for performing the job in the organization. Means the method is not decided by the personal wish of the manager, his, on the basis of his institution, on the basis of his past performance. The method is to be decided by scientific approach, scientific dealing, and for that method activity is to be conducted to find out which method is best that incur minimum cost and get maximum utilization of resources and get and provide a give maximum benefit to the organization as well as employees also. So for that he insists that, he suggests that method study should be conducted. For example, for producing shoes, two methods are there, that's we know it very well, labor intensive and capital intensive technique. So before implementing or before performing the job with which technique, we should analyze it, study it first, and in that we can analyze the cost of the techniques and also compare both the techniques, that the things, the resources are available in that technique or not before selecting it, and select the best method, best technique, which cause minimum cost and maximum utilization of resources and give maximum benefit. That method, that technique should be selected. That is not on the basis of past performance or personal wish of the manager. That is based on the conduction of method study. That is clear. Now the next topic, that is time study. Time study, it is to be conducted for what? It is to be conducted, time study, the objective, the aim of conducted time study, first to set up, to set the standard time for, set the standard time which is required to perform the job, to set the standard means to set the standard unit, that after that time, how much unit we have to set up that produce in one day, to also for making, it will also help to differentiate efficient, average and inefficient employee. That is clear. So before means the standard time for that is required for performing job, it is not decided by the personal wish or the intuition or the past performance of the manager. It is to be decided by conducting time study. So he suggests that when the worker is performing, while they are performing, observe that average workers while they are performing, and what we should do while they are performing, we will note it down, the time period which is required to fulfill. We are giving, suppose 10 units, standard 10 units we are giving. So how much time they are required, they are taking to complete that 10, And this experiment is to be repeated 100 times. When the same result will become, then it is to be, when average time it is to be decided by conducting this time study 100 times. And then we will decide, we are able to decide the standard time for performing that particular job. We are able to set up our objective, and even now how we are differentiate the inefficient and efficient employee. Suppose if the worker is complete that standard objective, standard unit, in that standard time he is to be considered as average worker. If he is completing that task before the standard time, then he is to be considered as efficient employee. In those worker, those who are completing their task after the standard time that is given to them, they are considered as inefficient employee. That is clear. Now the next, that is your fourth one, method study. That is clear to everyone. Motion study. The objective to conduct motion study is that to get to know the movement of employees while he is performing job, and also differentiate productive and unproductive movement of the employees. And we should classify in productive and unproductive movement and remove that unproductive and wasteful movement in the process, so the employees will put his efforts in a best way. So this movement, unproductive and productive, is not decided by a manager wish, manager intuition. It will be decided by conducting motion study. While the worker is performing his task, we should note it down that what movement he is doing. And while he is after noted down that movements, we should classify that movements into productive and unproductive, which are productive means productive movements, which are unproductive movements, and try to remove all the unproductive and wasteful movement. And by removing that unproductive, he will utilize that time and energy in his job for performing efficiently and effectively. For example, suppose while we are one worker is working, we should observe him that how many times he is moving from his place to another place, how many times he is bending, so that type of things. For example, he is doing one work, and for getting that tool, number of time he is bending to get that tool from the toolbox. So instead of that, what we should do, keeping one stool near to him and keep that toolbox on the stool. So it will reduce that unproductive movement that he is utilizing, that time and energy that he is using to bend and get that tools. If the tools is near to him, he will take the tools, and that energy and time he will utilize in his job, in his performance, and the task will complete efficiently and effectively. That is clear to everyone. Now the next topic, that is the fourth technique. These are under the work study. These techniques, I'm not coming to next. That is differential piece wage rate system. Means on the basis of that, the standard wage rate is to be the main objective to conduct this technique, is to decide a standard rate of the employees. As you know that we are divided on the basis of their efficiency and inefficiency, we are divided the worker in efficient and inefficient worker. Theek hai na? If the person, those who are producing more before the standard time, or standard, he is producing more than the standard output, obviously that person should get more wages, and those who are producing less, so they will get less. And what is the motto for that? That to make that person, those who are producing more than the standard time, to remain efficient, and also to motivate the inefficient employee to get in that efficient category. So for that, everyone are putting their more efforts. So for deciding a standard wages rate, what should be done? He suggested that we should take a standard output, and according to that standard output, we will decide our standard rate. For example, if a employee worker is producing 10 unit, so he will get 50 rupees per unit. So 50 into 10, and those who are producing 10 units, so they will get 10 into 50, 500 rupees, and they are considered as average worker. Those who are producing more, suppose one worker is there who is producing 12, so he will get 60 per unit. More than 10, so he will get 60 per unit. So 12 into 60, that is 720. He is considered as efficient employee and get 720. And those who are producing less, suppose one worker is producing 8 unit, so he will get less standard wages rate, that is 40 rupees. So 8 into 40, that is 320. So this is the thing to decide the standard rate and also motivate the employees to put his best efforts. If to remain an efficient employee, obviously those who are putting their best effort, those who are producing good number of units, will get a more amount also. So he will always put his best effort, and those who are not putting, they will, by getting these things, they will put their best efforts in future also. That is clear. Now the last technique, that is mental revolution. Mental revolution. According to this technique is to be used by Taylor. He insists to use that technique for what? For changing the outlook and attitudes of the management and workers towards each other. As you know, in the organization, two group of people are there, that is employer and employees, management and worker. Workers, what they are thinking? That we are overburdened, we are exploited, we are underpaid, we are getting less for our services. And on the other hand, management, they are thinking these workers are always grumbling, they are always creating problem, they are always arising unnecessary demand, they are always go for a strike, wasting our tools, damaging tools, equipments of the organization. So for that, he suggests that there is a need to change the outlook and attitudes of management and workers towards each other. There is a need to make your mind, change your mind in a positive thinking towards each other. When they are thinking, they will put their best efforts towards each other, and that is very important part of the organization if organization want to get success for a long period of time. That is clear to everyone. Chapter have finished. Thank you. Now the next principle, that is centralization. And decentralization. Centralization and decentralization. This is the 8 features that is given by Fiol. According to this feature, he insists that there is a combination of centralization and decentralization. Before it, we need to know what are these two terms. Centralization, it means a complete authority that is only in the hand of top level. And in decentralization, the authority is to be divided at every level of management. So according to Fuel, he insists that the company must not be a completely centralized or must not be decentralized, completely decentralized. There must be a combination of both centralization and decentralization. And even it can be applied, suppose if the firm is small, if the small organization is there, obviously there should be a centralization. And if large firm is there, there should be a decentralization of authority. Even if the firm, they have a trained employee, trustable, faithful employees, that they can go with the decentralization. But if the employees are not developed, not trained, and the manager, he hesitate to faith on that, then at that time there must be a centralization. But what Fuel insists, he insists that in the organization there must be a combination of both centralization and decentralization. Suppose the plan and policy, the major plan and policy, the objective of the firm, it is to be decided by the top level, and the other activities for the selection of employees, for purchasing of raw material, that type of authority is to be divided among the different level of management. That is clear. Now the next, that is principle of scalar chain. That is the next principle, that is principle of scalar chain. According to that principle, Fuel insists that if any information is to be passed, it must be passed from by following this chain. Scalar chains mean here the series of manager in the organization. The series of manager in the organization, that is from highest to lowest. And if any information is to be passed, that scalar chain should be followed, must be followed. I'm telling you by drawing this diagram. Suppose this is A, B, C, D, E, M, N, O, P. If B want to say to pass any information, it is to be passed from B to C, then C to D, D to E, E to M, then N, then O, and then P. Right? It is to be, so there will be a no communication gap between the manager and everyone know this information. One more thing, suppose if the information is urgent, whatever the information, if B want to pass any information or to give any information to O, so and there is an urgency to pass this message to O, obviously he must not be followed this long chain, that scalar chain. He should directly communicate with O with the process. That process is known as gangplank. Gangplank. That is clear to everyone. So this is a principle of scalar chain. 10th, that is principle of order. Principle of order. Here order means, it doesn't mean giving command, giving instruction to the employees. Here order means, according to this principle, Fuel insists that there must be a fixed place for the thing or the raw material in the organization, and there must be a fixed place or seat for the employees in the organization. According to that principle, he insists that. For example, suppose if supervisor have instructed to his employees to find that, to get this tool. So if that tool have a fixed place, the time will not waste.
the energy will not affects, and he is not wasting his time to finding that tool. Supervisor, he will tell you, in this box you will get this tool. He will get it and give it to him. That is clear. One more example I am giving to you. Suppose an employee, he want to give a information to sales manager, and if no fixed place is there, so he is going to find the sales manager in the whole organization, and it will waste the time, and even the information will not reach to that person on time. So if there is a fixed place, he will go there and tell to them, and he is going to implement it. That is clear. That is principle of order. Next, that is principle of equity. Here equity means fair, kind and just treatment toward every employees of the organization. Because if the employees are treated with kindness and justice, they will put their best efforts in their performance for achievement of organizational goal. Equity here doesn't mean the equal salary for the worker as well as for the manager. I'm telling one more example, a equal salary for peon or supervisor. No, it means there should be a equal treatment for everyone. The disciplinary part is to be applicable for each and equally for each and every member of the organization. Like rules and regulation, it is to be applied for equal for everyone. Leave rules, these are to be applied equally for everyone. It doesn't mean, suppose if a worker is going to take leave, his salary is going to be deducted, and his supervisor, he will get casual leave. No, there should be a equal leave irrespective of their post, job and gender. That is clear. Next, that is stability. Next principle, that is stability of tenure of personnel. Here person means stability. Stability here means no frequent transmission or transfer. No frequent transfer or transmission of employees. According to this feature, Fuel, he insists that there must be a stability of the employees in the organization. There will be no frequent turnover of employees, because this type of things, it's bad for the organization if there will be a increase in the turnover of the employees. Next, another thing also, with this turnover, no frequent transfer should also be avoided, because obviously a person will take a time to learn that job, and after when he has learned that job, and after few months he will transfer to another department, then whatever the knowledge he has got, whatever he has learnt over there in this department, it will going to be waste, and then in another department it will also take time. So it will waste of resources, wastage of time, and the firm will incur loss. So according to this feature, he insists that there should be stability in the organization of the employees. Next, that is principle of initiative. Principle of initiative. Sorry. initiative. According to this principle, he insists that initiative means taking step forward with self-motivation. According to this principle, he insists that the employees, the management, they encourage the employees to take initiative for giving their suggestion and telling their views regarding the plan, regarding the policy of the firm. According to this feature, he insists that the employees, they take initiative. The management, they involve the employees to take their initiative while preparing the plan. And whatever the suggestion is to be given by the employees, it must be welcomed by the suggestion must be welcomed by the management, and the good suggestion will be rewarded. So in future also they will take that type of initiative to improve the efficiency of the organization. But it doesn't mean initiative, it doesn't mean to disobedience. Means once the plan have been made, you have to follow that plan, you have to perform your activity according to that plan, whether it is according to your suggestion or not. You are not going to disobey if the plan is not according to your suggestion. Once the plan have been made, you have to follow it. That is clear. Now the last principle, that is esprit de corps. Here, esprit de corps means, according to this principle, he insists that there must be, the worker should work with team spirit. They must work that it is a group goal, it is not an individual goal. Means he insists that for removing I with we. I haven't performed this job. No, we have performed this job. I have performed. No, we have performed this job. For example, a production manager, he has assigned a work for manufacturing 100 units. 100 units of any product. And there are 10 employees. So this work is divided among these 10 employees. So according to that, if the work is divided, means each individual will manufacture 10 units. So they are not performing to giving due importance to their individual objective. They have to perform their task as a group activity, as a teamwork. Means suppose among the 8, 2 people fall sick, become sick. So the 8 employees, they are not saying that we have completed our 10 units. No, you are not going to achieve your goal. These 8 employees, they will divide that 2 employees work and achieve that group goal. Then the organization is able to achieve its goal. So he insists that the work should be go with teamwork, not individual, not giving due importance to individual objective. That is clear. Now the next, that is the another person that have given some scientific, these are the management principles that we have discussed. Now another person, that is F.W. Taylor, he has given some scientific principles, some scientific techniques, which is based on repeated experiment and observation. After that, it will be act as a scientific principles, scientific techniques. So I am going to tell you the another one person's principles. He is F.W. Taylor. Scientific management
मैन principles, scientific management principles. According to that, first of all, I am going to give you the introduction about F.W. Taylor. F.W. Taylor, he was born in USA in 1840. He was born in US. In 1878, he has become a mechanical engineer in one steel company. And by using his scientific techniques, scientific study, scientific managerial skills to make this company as a leading company. So he has given some scientific principles and techniques that I am going to tell you. First scientific principle he has given, that is science is not rule of thumb. Science is not rule of thumb. According to this Taylor, he insists that whatever the work is to be conducted in the organization, it must be carried out on scientific inquiry. It is not to be carried out on the basis of the manager's intuition, manager will, manager wish, and on the basis of his past experience that I have done, so they can also do. No, the work should be carried out in the organization, that is on the basis of scientific inquiry, which is not done in rule of thumb. Rule of thumb means dictatorship of manager, and in this manager will implement, he is going to tell that you have to do that work and at that time only. But whereas if I am talking about scientific management principles, these are based on scientific inquiry, means he insists that there must be thinking before doing. There must be thinking before doing. So he insists that whatever the work is to be conducted in the organization, it must be scientifically inquired before implementing that work, before doing that work. For example, for set a standard time to what is the required standard time to complete that job, it is not decided by the wish and will of the manager. It is to be decided by conducting time study, that we will discuss in this. These are the techniques that we will discuss later in the scientific techniques. So the standard time will tell you how much unit will be produced in that required time. That is clear. Next, that is harmony, not discord. According to this feature, Fuel insists that in the organization, the people, those who are working in the organization, they will work with mutual give and take. They must work with mutual give and take. As you know, in the organization, two group of people are there. One is employer and another is employees. And they were suspect to each other. Employees, they are thinking that we are overburdened and underpaid. At the same time, employer, what they thought, management, what they thought, that these workers, these employees are good for nothing. So, Taylor, he insists that there is a need to change your attitude, to change your outlook by mental revolution technique. For example, and you should work with mutual give and mutual take. For example, the employee's objective is to earn more and the organizational objective is for maximum production.
So the employees will earn more by producing more, and as they produce more, it will automatically achieve the organizational objective. So according to that, they can work together by changing the outlook, by changing their attitude towards each other. Next, that is next principle, that is cooperation, not individualism. That is clear, cooperation, not individualism. It is the extension of, it is the extension, this principle, it is the extension of harmony, not discord. In this, according to this feature, Taylor, he insists that the work must be carried out with cooperation to each other. Here, what he insists that, suppose before setting up the task, if this task will decide it by consulting with the employees, obviously they will put their best efforts as this task, this stand objective is decided after consulting them. Before consulting them, then this standard or the objective have decided. So they will put their best efforts. At the same time, employees should also not go for strike, not making any unnecessary demand, unreasonable demand. So there should be a open communication with each other, so it will be workable for everyone. Last principle, that is the fourth principle, that is development of workers to their greatest efficiency and prosperity. According to this principle, what, as you know, the industrial efficiency is always depend upon the employees' efficiency of the organization. Any organization efficiency is depend always upon the employees' efficiency. According to that principle, Taylor, he insists that while selecting the employees, due care should be taken. And after selecting them, the job is assigned according to their qualification and their capability. And they must be sent also for training, for enhancing their knowledge, their skills. So they will put their efforts, they will work, perform their task efficiently and effectively. And as, so because of this principle, it will improve the efficiency and prosperity of employees as well as organization. That is clear.